In this video, we are going to take a look at the data path, the address generator, and the processor memory interface. Each of these modules I have covered separately in my videos earlier, and you can check the playlist for this. Here, we are going to take a complete look at all these three modules together. So here we have assumed that we have a five-stage organization of the processor. And that means that each instruction would be executed in five stages. So the first stage would be to fetch the instruction from the memory and bring it to the processor. Second stage is to decode the instruction and read the source operands. Third stage is the compute part, where any computation that is required is done. Fourth stage is the accessing of memory. It could be for accessing the operands, and the fifth stage is for a write back to the register file. So as we know that at the end of the fetch cycle, the first stage, the instruction is brought from the memory and put in the instruction register IR. In the second stage, this instruction will be decoded, and whatever are the source operands, they will be read from the register file and put in these interstage registers RA and RB. In the third stage, these source operands will be passed on to the ALU, where the required computation will take place. The result of this computation will be available in the interstage register RZ. In the fourth stage, which is a memory access, the address of the location that is to be accessed in the memory will be sent on to the address bus, and the data bus will be used to get the operands. At the end of the fourth stage, if a memory access is required and a data is being brought from the memory to the processor, it will be available in RY. At the end of the stage 4, whatever operands were available in RY, they will be passed back to the register file in stage 5, which is the write back stage. So if any register needs to be updated or written into, it is done in stage 5. Let's take a look at some of the example instructions on how this five-stage organization works. So this is an example of one instruction, a very simple arithmetic instruction. I am assuming that in this ISA, these are the source operands, and the first operand is the destination register. That means contents of R2 and R3, they will be added and stored back in register R1. So in the first stage, which is the fetch stage, this instruction, it will be brought and placed in the instruction register. In the second stage, which is the decode stage, this decode part of the opcode will be done, and the source operands, which are R2 and R3, they will be read from the register file and will be available in the interstage registers RA and RB. In stage 3, appropriate control signal to the ALU for an add operation will be done. R2 will be passed here. In the MUX over here, 0 will be selected, and R3 will be passed on to the ALU, and the compute R2 plus R3 will take place, and the result will be placed in RZ. In the fourth stage, which is a memory access stage, in this particular instruction, no memory access is required. So whatever is this result, it will be passed on to RY, and RY will now contain this R2 plus R3 result at the end of stage 4. In stage 5, this result will be passed on back to be stored in register R1. So R1 will be written back with the correct result of R2 and R3 at the end of stage 5. Now let's take a look at another instruction, which is a load instruction. So here the memory address which needs to be accessed is 50 plus the contents of R7. This is the memory address which will be accessed, and the data from this address will be brought and put back into register R2. So at in stage 2, this instruction is being decoded, and the source operands, which is 50, which is the immediate value, this will be available from the instruction over here. And R7, it will be read from the register file and placed in interstage register RA. In stage 3, 50 plus R7 will happen in the ALU with an add operation. And the result of this will be available in register RZ. In stage 4, this address, which has been computed by the ALU and available in RZ, will be passed on to the address bus through RZ. The memory location of 50 plus R7, it will be accessed, and the data from that location will be brought via the data bus and through this multiplexer Y into RY. This data will be written back to register R2 in stage 5. In this instruction, store R3, R9. The data from this register has to be stored in the memory. And which memory location? That memory location is specified in register R9. So this memory access has to take place at this address, and the operand or the data from R3 has to be put in the memory location specified by register R9. At the end of stage 1, this instruction has been fetched and put in the instruction register. In stage 2, when it is being decoded, the source operand will be read. The source operand is R9 to get the address, memory address, and R3 to get the data which has to be sent to the memory for storage. So R3 will be read over here and placed in interstage register RB, and the address will come here in interstage register R9. Since there is no index or offset for R9, in stage 3, this R9 will be passed straight to RZ without any computation that is required. R3 value, the contents of R3, which is the data to be stored in the memory, will be passed on to RM register, again an interstage register, in stage 3. In stage 4, the memory address which was contained in R9 will be passed on to the address bus, and the data which is to be stored and available in RM will be passed on to the data bus and sent to the memory. So in stage 4, the memory access will take place. The data from R3 is now going to be stored in this address. In stage 5, which is the write back stage, nothing is required to be stored back in the register file. So no action will take place in stage 5. Now we have the next instruction, which is call R7. This instruction says that call a subroutine which is at the address given by the contents of register R7. That means the next instruction that has to be fetched is from this address. So suppose currently we were running this program and call R7 is the instruction that we have encountered, then the next instruction will be from a subroutine, say F1, and it will be fetched from there. When this subroutine finishes executing and we have to return from that subroutine, we will return back to the calling program. So if this instruction is executed, the contents of the new subroutine F1, which is available in register R7, this needs to be sent to the program counter, because the program counter will be the one which will decide where the next instruction has to be fetched from. Now the program counter is already pointing to the next instruction in the given program, which is running. So when we have to return back to the main program or to the calling program, these contents of the program need to be stored before we go to the subroutine. So this return address, it will be stored in a register which is called the link register and it is also available in the register file over here. So let's see how this, what will be the different stages of this instruction. So in call R7, at the end of the fetch stage, this instruction is available in the instruction register. In the decode stage, R7 will be read and put in register RA. And now it will be sent to the program counter in stage 3, and in stage 4, the return address from the program counter will be brought back to RY. So before the program counter is updated with this address of the subroutine R7, the return address is brought to RY and it is stored in the link register over here in the register file in stage 5. So this is how the call instruction will work. So we have seen that the 5-stage organization or the instruction execution cycle consists of fetch, decode and execute. So we have just now taken a look at the decode and the execute part. Now let's take a look at the fetch part. Fetch means fetching the instruction from the memory to the processor. So we know that the program counter stores the address of the next instruction to be fetched. So it will pass on the instruction address to a multiplexer over here, MUX-MA, and this address, it is sent to the address bus. Now the program counter is updated to point to the next instruction. So if we are having a sequential flow of the program, it is always incremented by 4, assuming that each instruction is of 4 bytes of length. So when it passes the address, the current address, at the same time the contents are sent to an adder and 4 is passed on to this adder and PC plus 4 goes back to the program counter. So the program counter is updated with this PC plus 4. Now there is also a possibility that we have a branch instruction which is being executed. So if a branch instruction comes and the offset is given, and so at the end of this instruction, the PC has to be updated with the target address. The target address is computed by doing a PC plus offset. So in that case, the PC value will be passed on to the adder and the offset which is coming from the instruction register bits, it will be sent to the adder. So the PC can be now updated with PC plus offset. So depending upon the multiplexer select value 0 or 1, either 4 or the offset will be sent to the adder over here. In case of a function call, the PC will be updated from the address of the routine which is stored in a register. Like if we have an example, like say call R9, this R9 will come from the register file via this interstage register RA. So in case there is a function call, then this address which needs to be now accessed in the next fetch of the instruction, so the PC has to be updated from this address coming from the register file via RA. So this, if RA is being selected for updating the PC, then the MUX will select 0 and pass on this new value of the call function to the program counter. Before updating the PC, the current contents of the PC will be sent to a temporary register PC temp, which will then be passed to MUX-Y for being written into the link register like we just saw in the previous slide. Once the return address has been put in PC temp, then PC will be updated with the new value of the function. So this is how the updation of the program counter happens. and the address is sent from the program counter to via this multiplexer and onwards to the address bus. Now this instruction will be fetched from the memory location in the memory, and this address is given by the address bus. So let's see what happens when the instruction comes back. When we are sending out the address for an instruction fetch, at the same time we have to send a memory read signal because we want to read the memory to fetch the instruction. The instruction will come via the data bus, and once that memory function is complete, it will send a memory function complete signal, memory function complete signal to the processor. On receiving this function MFC signal, the instruction will be loaded into IR. So IR enable will be activated and the instruction will come in the instruction register. From here, the opcode bits will be read, the instruction will be decoded, and the control circuit will generate appropriate control signals depending upon the kind of instruction that has come. From this instruction register, certain bits of the instruction can also be read for taking out the immediate bits. So the bits which are specifying the immediate value in case the addressing mode is immediate, they are also read and they are sent to the MUXB which was in the data path or to the MUX of the program counter over here if we are reading the offset value. So this is how the instruction part is read. Now there is a possibility that apart from the reading of the instruction, the memory has to be accessed again. So this could be in case of a load operation or a store operation. A load operation would require reading the memory so that we get data from the memory to the processor. In a store operation, we have a write operation. In this case, the data is sent from the processor to the memory. So now if the memory access is required in load or store operations, and which is in stage 4, which we have seen earlier, which is a memory access stage, then again we need the memory address. And this address, as we have seen in the data path, comes from the register RZ, which is the output register or the interstage register just after the ALU. So from this register RZ, which contains the operand address, it is passed on to this multiplexer. Now you see this, the need of this multiplexer MA. It will either select the instruction address, which is in stage 1, when the instruction is being fetched, or it will select the operand address in stage 4 when the memory is being accessed for a read-write operation to fetch or to read operand or to write an operand. So this address will again go to the address bus. If it is a load operation, then a memory read signal will be generated. If it is a store operation, then a memory write operation will be generated. So depending upon whether it is a load or a store operation, that particular control signal will be generated and the address of the operand from register RZ will be passed on to the address bus. So here is the processor memory interface, which is passing, which is an interface between the processor on one side and the memory on the other side. Once the address of the operand has been passed on to the address bus, that memory location will be accessed. So if it was a load operation, so the data from the memory will come via the data bus to the processor and a memory function complete signal will be received from the memory. This data which is coming in from the memory will go into MuxPy, and from here it will be passed on to the register file via register RY. If it was a store operation and we have sent the address to the memory, then we also need to send the data to the memory because it is a write operation, and that data we have seen is coming from the interstage register RM. So the operand will be sent via the processor memory interface to the memory now. So the data will be sent at this particular address, which has been sent by RZ, and data will be now stored in the memory. Once the memory location has been accessed and data has been stored, a memory function complete signal will be received from the memory to show that the operation is complete. So in this video, we have seen how the data path works, how the address generator works, and what happens at the processor memory interface.